Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Good evening and welcome again to another evening of Pentecost 2000. It has certainly been a wonderful day here in Illinois. It's a little chilly, but really beautiful. And tonight's subject is a subject that I really would ask that you would pray hard about, and that is the gift of speaking in tongues, the gift of the Holy Spirit. So many people have experienced speaking in tongues. So many churches teach different things about speaking in tongues. And tonight we want to explore exactly what the Bible says about this gift of speaking in tongues, because brothers and sisters, it is biblical. The Bible does indeed speak of the gift of tongues. Also, before we do that, I want to again once more speak of this book that you might be interested in getting, Thy Nakedness, Lord, What Shall I Wear? And it's interesting that the preface to this book is written by a very familiar evangelist. Well, he's a late evangelist, Joe Cruz, with the Amazing Facts. He was one of the founders of Amazing Facts. He built that up into a beautiful ministry, which is now Doug Batchelor is the president of that ministry. Well, he wrote the preface to this book, and if you're interested in getting it, you can get it at the toll-free number listed right here on your screen, 1-888-266-5047, or you can also get it through that email address. Now, that is not my personal email. That is only for ordering books. If you'd like to contact me or the Present Truth Ministry and be on our mailing list, we encourage you to write P.O. Box 494, West Frankfort, Illinois, 62896. That's P.O. Box 494, West Frankfort, Illinois, 62896. Feel free to write us. Please, if you don't write, keep us in your prayers. And now we ask that you would just pray now for the Holy Spirit to really bless this subject. It's a sensitive subject to me as we enjoy and are blessed to enter into the worship with Pastor Nimhart as he sings.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the Savior God, to thee. great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Beautiful song. What a beautiful song. I love singing that song. If you can join me in singing Into My Heart.
Into my heart.
You can sing.
Into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus,
into my heart,
into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, come in.
Before we open the Word of God. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the promise that says, all that the Father giveth thee shall come to you, and to him that cometh you shall in no wise cast out. We come now, Lord, and we ask that you would please place us in the heart of Jesus. We pray that the Holy Spirit would really teach us. Teach us, Lord, so that we can really understand that which is from your word. And no matter what an experience may be or may have been, let us to always go by your word rather than any experience or any principle. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Out of my heart, out of my heart.
Out of my heart, out of my heart, shine out of my heart, Lord Jesus, shine out.
Amen. Amen. You know, it's never an easy way to approach certain subjects because there are many sincere Christians that for years do certain things, and especially when you deal with various manifestations that are real, that are not made up, that bring about various types of feelings and sensations, A lot of times when we learn certain things, if we have any type of physical engagement, to later be told that it's not of God makes one come to a conclusion that if it's not of God, it is of who? Satan. And for some reason or another, if a man stood up or a woman stood up tonight and started trying to speak, and all of a sudden a deep man's voice started coming out of her, and all of a sudden their eyes started rolling back and they fell on the floor, and someone stood up and prayed over that person, and their right mind came to them, and everyone in the room would have noticed that they had been possessed by a demonic force. We look at that person and we say, wow, that person really was possessed. And we somehow or another equate that as being worse than if you decide to go to the store and buy a beer and drink a beer, or if you decide to tell a lie, or if you decide to commit adultery, or if you decide to steal something. It's all pressed upon, implemented, and empowered by Satan, and one is no different from the other. It's that sometimes the devil likes to disguise himself and make it appear as though there are worse people that are worse off than others. When we approach the gift of speaking in tongues, there is a biblical way and there is a way that has been manipulated by Satan. And I'd like to begin this study in Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews, what chapter are we turning to? Hebrews 13. And notice what the Word of God says in Hebrews 13. O God of heaven, I thank you for being all powerful, and I thank you for the power that comes when one is in Christ. Place me in the heart of Jesus, Lord, and please, I pray, be with those who will listen around the world and make your word ever so clear in Christ's name. Amen. The foundational text that I like to use, that the Lord impressed me to use when I stood up in this desk, I'm not ashamed to tell you that I didn't really know how to approach the subject. I'm not ashamed to tell you that right now I'm depending on God, and that God told me when I stood here to use this as a foundational text. Hebrews 13, beginning with verse 8, the Bible says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace. But the focus is Jesus, the same yesterday, the same today, and the same forever. When Christ communicates with man throughout the Word of God, Jesus always communicated with God in man's language. Never did we find in the Bible where Jesus communicated with God outside of man's, or with man outside of man's language, except one time in the Scripture do we see God using any other language. The Bible says in the book of Genesis, let's look in Genesis at a few examples of how God spoke with man. The Bible says in the book of Genesis chapter 3, and you know the story, God created the heavens, he created the earth, he gave it to Adam and Eve as a gift, and after giving them this gift, he simply said in chapter 2, listen, of all the trees of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But he says in Genesis 2, beginning with verse 16, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely what? Die. We see God talking to Adam in Adam's language. Amen? He's not talking in any unknown language, Adam. And God's speaking to Adam, and now Adam sins. After sin, God doesn't change. God still communicates and speaks to Adam in man's language. Notice what it says in Genesis chapter 3, Genesis 3, beginning with verse 9. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? Where are you, Adam? And Adam talks back to God, and he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. So here we see God speaking to Adam in man's language, and now Adam speaking directly back to God in man's language, and this is the way we see it throughout the Bible. As a matter of fact, go to Genesis chapter 18 with me. You remember in Genesis 18, something spectacular happened. As a matter of fact, brothers and sisters, I often wonder how much of a privilege it would be today, or would it be a curse if Jesus himself came in the form of a man and came to your home, how welcome would he feel? Well, this is what happened in Genesis 18. The Lord came to Abraham's house. In Genesis 18, notice what the Bible says in Genesis, what chapter are we going to? 18, beginning with verse 2, and he lift up his eyes, talking about Abraham. I'll begin with verse 1. It says, and the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre, and he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day, and he lifted up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground and said, My Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray thee, from thy servant. Let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree, and I will fetch a morsel of bread, and comfort ye your hearts. After that ye shall pass on, for therefore are ye come to your servant. And they said, So do as thou hast said. And Abraham hastened unto Sarah. And then all of a sudden they start dialoguing. In verse 10, the Bible says, And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. This is Jesus talking to Abraham, man speaking in man's language again. And you see Abraham dialoguing in God's language. No, in human language. Amen? So here we see a pattern. God talking to man talking to God in man's language. As a matter of fact, let's look at Exodus chapter 3. And I want to show these few examples. And by the way, there are more examples in the book of Genesis, but I'd like you to see in Exodus 3, and I'm trying to point out examples that come to mind that people are familiar with. Everyone's familiar with what took place in Genesis chapter 18. That real conversation that took place was that God was about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. That Sodom and Gomorrah, their sins had filled the cup, and there was no more room for mercy. And Abraham pleaded and said, Lord, because he loved his nephew that was there in that town. And he said, Lord, listen, if there be 50, he said, listen, if it's 50 people, I'll spare the whole town. And then he said, how about 40? How about 30? Got all the way down to 10, and he became quiet. He was afraid because if Abraham would have said, Lord, if there be one, and God would have made that deal, then Lot and his family would not have been saved. Because Lot, brothers and sisters, his mind had become absorbed with the things of Sodom also. He was saved by the mercies of God, but Lot moved and pitched his tent towards Sodom, and this is why it's dangerous to keep your mind on the things of the world, because when your mind is on the things of the world, before you know it, your mind will be worldly. He moved and pitched his tent towards Sodom, but when the angels came, he was living in Sodom. And now all of a sudden, you know what happened. I praise God for God-fearing relatives who are praying for those who are lost. The Bible says in Exodus 3, you know Moses, a humble shepherd, wondering whether he ever really has a place with God again. And the Bible says in verse 2 of Exodus 3, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see God, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Now this is God talking to Moses. Moses to God in human language. No secret, no mysterious language. And it goes on where God tells Moses what he wants him to do. One writer said that the reason why he had to take those shoes off is because they were leather. They were from the hide of a cow. And they said that if that death would have come in the presence of God, it would have come back alive. Death can't stand in the direct presence of an almighty God. And here Moses is in the sight of God. Take off those shoes. Get the death away from me. You're on holy ground. And he starts talking to God. And God says, Moses, listen, I want you to go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And Pharaoh says, like many of you, he starts making excuses as to why he can't do what God says do. He says, I can barely talk, Lord. Lord said, don't say you can't talk. And he kept on complaining until finally God said, listen, I'll give you a mouthpiece. And he complained one more time. And God said, okay, that's it. And Moses humbled himself. Who's going to send me? And he said, God. It was again God talking to man in man's language. As a matter of fact, brothers and sisters, even when we look at Jesus, when we look at Jesus, Jesus spoke to man in man's language, not in a different language. Jesus did not have the gift of tongues. He did not have it. Jesus spoke to man and to God in clear utterances that were understood by man. As a matter of fact, notice what the Bible says in the book of Mark, chapter 9. Mark, what chapter are we going to? Mark chapter 9. And I'm going through this for a reason, because I want to drive in the point that the Lord God is the same today, yesterday, and forever. God doesn't change. God does what he does exactly the same way. The Bible says in Mark chapter 9, beginning with verse 1, and he said unto them, Verily I say unto you that there shall be some that of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. And after six days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into the high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. For he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. Here it is, God speaking again. And he allowed all to hear, and he spoke in man's language. And it's interesting what he said. He said, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And he said that for a reason, because he knew that Jesus was about to die. He knew he was on his way to the grave, and the disciples could not see beyond the grave. They could not understand any talk of Jesus, one with power to resurrect dying. And so in the original language, what this is really saying is, listen, here, this is my beloved Son, hear him, even though you don't understand him, hear him anyway. And here God again speaks to man in man's language. When Jesus resurrected, brothers and sisters, when he was on high, he still spoke to man. Now, many people say that one of the criterias for speaking in tongues is, or a sign of being filled with the Holy Spirit, is that you speak in tongues. Well, notice what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1. Revelation, what chapter are we going to? Revelation chapter 1. The Bible clearly says that John was in the Spirit. Notice what it says in Revelation, what chapter are we going to? Revelation chapter 1. O God of heaven, I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit would fall in a real way in this room, and not only in this room, to all the thousands of honest Christians listening, so that your truth can be proclaimed and people can follow you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, beginning with verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia and Ephesus and unto Smyrna and Pergamos and unto Thyatira and unto Sardis and Philadelphia and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and I being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. Here God again is speaking to man in man's language. Well, some people say, but wait a minute, what about when man would pray? Well, when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, certainly Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, how much more filled can a man be? And he prayed in man's language to God. He said, Lord, Father, if this cup can be taken from me, he said, if it's any other way, if I don't have to go to Calvary and man can still be saved, please show me that way. But not my will, thine be done. He still was speaking in man's language. Well, all of a sudden, this is supposed to have changed. People say that after the day of Pentecost, a gift was given to man, and it was a sign of man's experience or being filled with the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, I had a very sincere Christian man come to me the other night, and he looked at me and he said, I know you must speak in tongues. And I said, why do you say? He said, because I watch you every night on television when you come home. He said, and I come when I can to the meetings. He said, and I can feel the power of the God in your meetings, and I feel the power of God when you preach, so I know you must have it. And I said, well, I have it the right way. And he said, well, come on, what do you mean? I said, I'll speak on it Tuesday night. Or Monday night. I said, I'll speak on it Monday night. Why don't you come out and hear? Brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. Nowhere in the Bible do you find that the Bible says that the Holy Spirit, you having the Holy Spirit, is a sign of you speaking in other languages or in another tongue. You don't find the Bible saying that this is evidence that you are having this experience. Now, some churches teach that you don't have the Holy Spirit until you do it. And some teach you how to do it. Some get you caught up in speaking repetitiously until it happens. Others say that you pray and all of a sudden you just start doing it. And I've met sincere Christians. One woman told me that in her experience, she had certain feelings that overtook her body while doing it. And that's why she loved doing it. She thought she was having special experiences with the Holy Spirit. But what does the Bible teach? Let's read what the Bible says and let the Bible do its own talking. Amen? Notice what it says in the book of Acts. Let's go to the book of Acts because this is where many quote from, and I just want the Bible to speak for itself. I want the Word of God in its own simplistic way to speak for itself. The Bible talks about this day of Pentecost, this great day of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And notice what it says, brothers and sisters. And by the way, I think I need to insert this right here. We can't put something in the Bible that doesn't exist in the Bible. No matter what your experience is, no matter what my experience is, if it's not in the Word of God, we can't make it biblical. Amen. If it's not here, we can't make it biblical. For instance, the word tongues. When you look in the Greek, the word tongues, no matter where you see it, it's one of two Greek words. The first is glossa. Let me hear you say glossa. Glossa, very easy. See, you're speaking Greek tonight. And the other is dialectos. Let me hear you say dialectos. Dialectos. Nowhere else is there any other word found in the Bible that is not synonymous in Hebrew, but in Greek, in the New Testament, those are the only two words that are found whenever you see the word tongue. Glossa, that's where we get our word glossary. It means your motherland tongue, the native tongue that you are born in. In other words, glossa for me would mean English. That's the language that I was raised or reared learning. Dialectos means a foreign language, a language that you can learn that is opposite to the one that you were raised under. Now, if you find something in the Bible that doesn't line up to either the native tongue that you grew up with or a foreign language that you can learn, then, brothers and sisters, you're putting something in the Word that's not there. And you can go and search all through the Greek. You do not find any other words except glossa and dialectos. Those two words are the only two words found. So when people come to me and they say, wait a minute, but I know that I'm speaking in a language that is unknown to men, but it's known to God. And I don't know what I'm saying to God, but God knows what I'm saying. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. First of all, I don't want to talk to God unless I know what I'm saying to God. Because how do you know or differentiate whether it's Satan, even if it was a real gift? If it was a true gift where I could communicate with God and I don't know the language and no one else knows the language around me, or some say, well, they can interpret, but if I didn't know what I'm saying, how can they interpret? How can I trust their interpretation? And it's serious. I don't ever want to say something to God. As a matter of fact, one person was speaking in this so-called unknown tongue. And by the way, they have found through studies that when they have recorded people, that they have found that many of them are indeed speaking legitimate foreign languages. And one person was cursing God, believing they were praying to God in an African native tongue. And they had never learned this. So yes, it was charismatic. Yes, it came from a supernatural power, but certainly the Holy Spirit wouldn't give you the ability to cuss God or to curse God. And so it's serious. So let's look at this a moment. And we must remember, dialectos, foreign language, glossa, language that you are raised with. Amen? Notice what the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. And I want to say this other thing before it slips my mind. I need to say it while it's right there. Listen, do you remember in Daniel chapter 2? You remember the devil does not have the ability to read your mind? So if you want to talk to God privately, brothers and sisters, all you have to do is be quiet and pray. The devil can't read your mind. You don't have to say anything. He cannot read your thoughts. And in Daniel chapter 2, it's evident that he cannot read your thoughts. And by the way, brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. The reason why people say that they need to speak in this language is to protect themselves from the devil hearing. What can the devil do about my prayers, whether he hears them or not? What can he do? He can't do anything but get afraid. He can't stop anything I pray for. As a matter of fact, sometimes I kneel down and I pray and I want to talk to God out loud. So I say, Father in heaven, I'd like to have a private talk with you. And I pray that every demonic force and unclean spirit would be bound and cannot hear the conversation. And you know what? If my son Samuel runs up to me and says, Daddy, I want to talk to you privately, wouldn't I take him away and listen to him privately? And I wouldn't let anyone listen. And I believe if I say that to the Father, he moves where me and him can talk privately. And the devil, if he does hear, he doesn't have any power. If he had power, he would have stopped this meeting. If he had power, he would have stopped your baptism. If he had power, he would stop and shut down this station. But he doesn't have the power to do it. It doesn't matter what happened. You know what? A bazooka couldn't blow it down unless God gives the authority. If he had power, and he's powerless, but we give him too much credit. And he loves for us to run around and think that we have to hide something from him because he has power to do something about our prayers. He can't do anything about our prayers. Nothing, brothers and sisters. He must go by God to do anything. And the Bible says in Acts 2, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It wasn't a literal mighty wind. It was as of a rushing mighty wind. Just like the Bible in John talks about the born-again experience, he likens it unto the wind. In other words, you don't know where it comes from. You don't know where it ends up, but you see the change that takes place as a result of the wind. And the Bible goes on to say, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues. You look that up in the original language. It's talking about different tongues or different gifts were given to them right there. Before it even goes on, you look it up and you'll find this as you research it. But it even gets clear itself. I don't have to even say that. Like as of a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other what? Tongues or foreign languages. That word there, it's speaking of a foreign language. It's not speaking of something nobody knows. They weren't in there just experiencing something, and I'm not going to try to laugh. I don't want to make a joke of it because there are honest, spirit-filled Christians who are held and bound by this particular thing. But you need to know that this isn't talking about what churches today are manifesting. It says, and they speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, and there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that they heard every man, that every man heard them speak in his own what? Language. Could you imagine If we had people from all different languages in this room right now, and when I stood up to speak, they all heard in their own language. We don't know for sure whether or not they were actually hearing my words and hearing it in their language, or whether or not these languages were, we don't really understand what took place that day. We do know it was a miracle. They heard all these disciples except one. Remember, all the disciples didn't have this gift. Notice what the Bible goes on to say. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men. And it said, how do we hear everybody hear our own language? And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue or own what? Language. There it is again. How do we hear every man in our own language or own tongue wherein we were born? Glossa. How can we hear all these people speak who we know never had any lessons in our own language? How are they doing this? It was a miracle, brothers and sisters. And the Bible goes on to announce who all were there. There were Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers of Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia and Phrygia and Pamphylia and Egypt and parts of Libya about Cyrene and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians. We do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. How do we do it? Look, this has to be God. We know that they wouldn't know all these languages. And all of a sudden, there's always a skeptic in the crowd. The Bible says, and they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea. You see, Peter wasn't preaching in another language. But the Spirit of God fell on him because he was in the upper room. But he stood up to speak, and he spoke in the regular language. He said, listen, you men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words, for these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall speak in tongues, and your young men shall speak in tongues, and your old men shall speak in tongues, and on my servants and on my handmaids I will pour out in those days my spirit, and they shall speak in tongues. Is that what the Bible says? No. The Bible says when the Spirit was poured out, they would prophesy. They would dream dreams. They would have visions. Nowhere did it say that it was prophesied that when the Spirit of God is poured out, you'd speak in tongues. Now let's read it the way it's really read. The Bible says, and it shall come to pass in the last days, saith the Lord, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams, and on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days my spirit, and they shall what? Prophesy, and I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor and smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness. Then it starts talking about those prophecies that we talked about last night. So God said, when the power comes, they're going to prophesy. As a matter of fact, I want to go even further, and I want to go to the book of 1 Corinthians. You see, brothers and sisters, the book of 1 Corinthians, by the way, many people call it the book of corrections. And you'll learn that when you look in the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, you will find that all throughout the book of 1 Corinthians, you'll find that Paul is going through correcting problems in the church. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, let's start there because they talk about gifts. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and remember, brothers and sisters, let's never concern or never confuse the gifts of the Spirit with the fruit of the Spirit. Let's never get those confused because Satan can manipulate the gifts, not the fruit. Amen? Amen. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. In other words, he's starting by saying, listen, everybody will not have the same gifts. I cannot sing. Somebody else can sing. Amen. I cannot build. Somebody else can. Now, I can learn that gift, and I can learn to maybe hold a note and sing in the background of a choir. But certain people who are given that gift will always outshine. Why? Because that's their gift that God has given them. And by the way, we're going to be held accounted for how well we used our gifts. The Bible goes on to explain that these gifts that are all given by the Holy Spirit are given so that the church can be one. Amen? Notice what the Bible goes on to say. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of what? Tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. So it says, listen, it's at the bottom of the list. To one is given different types of languages, to another the ability to explain or understand different languages. And it's at the bottom of the list. God always placed that one at the bottom. Notice what it goes on to say, brothers and sisters. It says very clearly, but all these worketh, in verse 11, that one of the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. And then then it goes on explaining. And by the way, brothers and sisters, it explains beautifully. It says, what if every part of your body was an eye? Where would your hearing come from? And often your legs may get the credit for running so fast in a race, but if your heart wasn't pumping, how good would those legs be? And so he's likening the church body unto the physical body, saying that we should not elevate one above another. One of the things that baffles me every time is when I hear someone say this about someone else. Oh, he is really intelligent. And I say, is he? Oh, yes, he's a brain surgeon. Oh, so in other words, he's intelligent as a brain surgeon. Oh, no, he's an intelligent man. Okay, well, what does he do when his plumbing goes wrong? Who's intelligent now? What does he do when his car breaks down or he throws a rod on his car? Does he know what a rod is in the engine of his car? You see, so intelligence is relevant, brothers and sisters, to what you know. In other words, when it's time to build a house, I don't care how good of an electrician you are. When it's time for your house to be built and the bricks to be laid, you need a mason. You need a bricklayer. And all of a sudden, your wisdom and skill in that area diminishes and the others come forward. But when you work together, the house is complete. Amen? And by the way, I've seen products from people who have tried to do it all when they weren't gifted to do it. It just boggles me how someone will look at a man who's a farmer and they'll never say, oh, that man is intelligent. Yet if it wasn't for him, we would starve. This man knows how to handle the crop. He knows how to grow things so that we can eat. He knows what to do to fatten the cows. But we will never say he's as intelligent as an astronaut. But God says, yes, he is. God says every part of the body. And this is what has happened to the deterioration of churches all around the world. We have big I's and little U's all through the church. We have people that are so important and other people who are nobodies because we have limited what true intelligence is. I'll tell you what, you let that good janitor stop coming to the church and let's see how good the doctor is. Amen. His gift is just as important. I tell the Bible workers, your gift is just as important as mine is. I tell a greeter at the door, your gift is just as important as mine is. There was a man who joined one of the churches, the big church, the biggest church in Huntsville, Alabama. And this man finally joined after coming for almost a year. And the pastor was excited. He said, oh, he just really knew that this time the appeal was strong. This time the sermon had hit his heart. And when the man got baptized and gave his testimony, he said, that lady over there greeted me with such genuine love and such warmth, I would come each Sabbath for that. He didn't come to hear the sermon. He came to feel loved. That greeter preached the sermon, and he didn't even know it. Every gift in the church, brothers and sisters, whoever fills the baptismal pool is doing an important job, just as important as the man that preaches every night. Because with no water in that pool, if the pool isn't cleaned out, what good is my preaching? What would happen if we would have gone over to the pool and it would have been empty? What would have happened if the man didn't want to run water into it? What could I have done? You can't baptize in air. Every gift is equal, the Bible says. But what happened was, they started getting caught up in the church believing that if you spoke in tongues, you were smarter or sharper or a better theologian than everybody else. Wow, that kind of seems familiar to me. Some people like to put their chests out and say, but in the Greek it says, or but in the Hebrew it says. Guess what? The spirit of prophecy was written in English. Amen. Amen. And you can get a computer and type up with a Greek program and sound like a scholar in Greek, brothers and sisters, or Hebrew. But if we would humble ourselves before God with our gift, you see, but back then they thought, listen, if I know these different languages, I can get up in church and speak the different languages. People go, wow, he's filled with the Spirit. He is really Spirit-filled. Now I'd get up to a congregation like you and I'd start speaking in French. And I'm preaching, I mean, I'm sweating, and I'm preaching my heart out in French. And you guys don't understand a word I'm saying, but you're looking at me going, boy, he's filled with the Spirit because he has the gift of tongues. And so Paul knew that this was going on. And he said, I need to deal with the church of Corinth. So he goes to the church of Corinth, and he says, first he deals with chapter 12, then he talks about the most important gift. But notice, before we move there, notice the list or where tongues comes in verse 28. It says, God have set some in the church, first apostles, secondly, and he names the importance, and secondarily, prophets, thirdly, teachers. We're in verse 28 of 1 Corinthians 12. After that, miracles, then gifts of healings, then helps, governments, diversities of what? Tongues. It's always the last one. He said, do everybody, or is everyone apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? In other words, he's asking the question but answering, no, everybody doesn't have all these gifts. So we can't say that one gift is a proof or evidence that a man has the Holy Spirit. The evidence of the Holy Spirit in a man's life is that he will obey God by the power of the indwelling Christ. He will manifest the fruit of the Spirit, according to Galatians 5:22. Thank you. Amen. So he will manifest those fruit. And it's not fruits, the fruit, let me say. He says, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet I show you unto a more excellent way. And then he deals with it in detail in chapter 14. Now, here is where the confusion comes to a lot of people. But let's read it, and let's just let the Bible do the talking. Notice what the Bible says. Follow after charity. In other words, love is more important than any of these gifts. If you stutter, you can't do anything but love. You have everybody else beat. Amen? Nothing like a sweet spirit. Amen. The Bible says, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts. You should want spiritual gifts. But rather that ye may what? Prophesy. And when it's talking about prophesy here, guess what? It's not talking about the gift of a prophet where you see into the future. You see, I've heard people say, I prayed and asked God to make me a prophet. Doesn't happen like that. You don't find anywhere in the Bible where somebody prayed and said, let me be a prophet, and they became a prophet. God selects in his own way who a prophet will be. But to prophesy also means when you teach prophecies where people can understand what the prophecy means. You are prophesying. And so I said, listen, above everything, desire to be able to teach what the prophecies mean so that people can be edified and know what's happening. Notice what it goes on to say. It says, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto who? Under God. Do you see that word unknown? How many of you have a word unknown in your Bible? How many of you notice that that word is italicized? Let me see your hand. That word italicized simply means it was a supplied word. They supplied it because in the original language, they would not have needed it because they just changed the last two letters in your Greek and it makes the whole word mean something different. So it wasn't talking about a tongue that nobody knew of. It was just talking about a language that no one else understood. but they supplied that word so that as we read it in English, we would know it. And that's why every time you see that word unknown, you'll notice as we read in chapter 14 that it's italicized. But remember, don't forget there are two words, glossa and dialectos. Long as you keep that in mind, you won't go wrong as you read this. Notice what it goes on to say. But he that speaketh in an unknown tongue or in a different language speaketh not unto men but unto God. Yes, if I come in here right now and I start talking in French or in German, some of you, I'm not speaking to you, but God understands. Okay, now watch what it goes on to say. For no man understandeth him, howbeit he in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. But he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself, but he that prophesieth edifieth the church. You get up here and you speak in a language nobody understands, you're building yourself up. Edify means to build up. You're lifting yourself up. You're not doing anything for the church. That's what he was saying. And they were doing it, brothers and sisters. Notice what it goes on to say. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself, but he that prophesieth edifieth the church. If I teach you, you're built up, you're lifted up. I would that ye all spake with tongues. Paul said, I wish that all of you spoke in different languages. Notice what he says. I would that ye all spake in tongues, but rather that ye prophesied. For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with tongues, except he interpret that the church may receive edifying. Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, except what shall I profit you, except I shall speak by to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine, and even things without life giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? That's how they knew it was a war. There was a certain tone that trumpet would blow, and the men would be ready for battle. But if it gave an uncertain tone, everybody be relaxed. He goes on to say, so likewise, ye, except ye utter by the tongue words hard to be understood. What does it say? Words easy to be understood. How shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air. There are, it may be, so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them is without signification. In other words, he says, listen, whole lot of languages, but every one of them can be tied to one of God's tribes or one of the nations. None of them are just out there. And somebody said, wait a minute, but what about the language of angels? In Job chapter 1, God spoke to Lucifer and told us about that conversation. And it was no specific tongue. He said, what are you doing here, Lucifer? And Lucifer said, well, I've been in earth, running up and down in it, seeing who I could devour. He said, oh, well, have you considered my servant Job? It was no special language of an angel. Notice what the Bible goes on to say. There are, it may be, many kinds of voices in the world, verse 10, and none of them is without signification. Therefore, if I know not the meaning of the voice, I shall be unto him that speaketh a barbarian, and he that speaketh shall be a barbarian unto me. Even so ye, for as much as ye are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek that ye may excel to the edifying of the church, or seek that you may prophesy. That's what it's saying. Wherefore, let him that speaketh in an unknown language or an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is it then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with what, brothers and sisters? I will pray with what? Let's read that together. I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with understanding also. I don't want to pray and not know what I'm praying. That's the Bible. How much clearer can it be? I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. Else when thou shalt bless with the Spirit, how shall he that occupieth the room of the unlearned say amen? At thy giving of thanks, seeing he understandeth not what thou sayest. If you start praying, and all of a sudden you don't know what they're saying, how can you say amen? How can you agree? That person may have just said, Lord, I pray that this individual be cursed who I'm dealing with. When you say amen, God, I agree with that prayer. You want to pray with understanding. You want to sing with understanding. Everything you do should be with understanding. And you know what? That's why I always talk about music. Because too many musicians are not held to the standard that they should be held to. They can have affairs. They could have any type of lifestyle. They could be gamblers. They can have jobs on the Sabbath. They could have anything. They could do anything. And we don't cry. If you could sing, get right on up there. And I think that they should have the same standard held as a minister. Why? Because in the Bible, the musicians for service were ministers. They were paid from the tithe. They were held accountable. We should just let anybody, just because they have a nice voice, jump up and sing. Amen. We need to know that they're understanding what they're singing. The lyrics match what the Bible teaches, because there's a lot of songs that don't match. There's one song, they say, I will lift up my head toward the hills from which cometh my help. And oh, they sing it, and it's beautiful when you hear it. But when the psalmist said, I will lift up my head toward the hills from which cometh my help coming from the Lord. Let me tell you something. What he was saying, if you look in your margin, is, shall I look lift up my head to the hills. See, up in the hills were all the pagan gods. They put them in the highest, loftiest place they could. And the people would say, so David said, shall I lift up my head to the hills for my help? No, my help cometh from the Lord. Out of heaven, I don't need these man-made things in the hills. And people sing that song, and oh, they just bellow it out, and the theology's wrong. They're not singing with understanding. So the Bible says, listen, when I sing, I need to sing with understanding. Then he says, what then? In verse 15, I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with an understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with understanding also. Else, when thou shalt bless with the Spirit, how shall he that occupy the room say amen? Verse 17, for thou verily givest thanks well, but the other is not edified. I thank my God, Paul says. I speak with tongues more than ye all. He's spoken more languages than anybody. He said, I thank God that I speak in more languages than anybody. But notice what he goes on to say. He says, I thank my God that I speak with more tongues than more than ye all. Yet in the church, I had rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. Brethren, be not children in understanding. Howbeit in malice be ye children, but in understanding be men. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people. And yet for, now this is a powerful text, get this. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people. And yet for all that will they not hear me, saith the Lord. Wherefore tongues are for a sign, not to them that what? Wait a minute now. Did you get what those two texts just said? In other words, Paul said, God prophesied and said, I'm going to speak in your language. And you're still not going to believe. Tongues are for a sign of the unbeliever. In other words, on the day of Pentecost, all these different Jews from all these different places were unbelievers. They didn't believe in the resurrection of Christ. They didn't believe in what took place. And then God's children had no way to communicate what took place to them. So God gave them the gift of tongues, and he gave it to them that didn't believe, so that those who didn't believe could hear, so he could communicate to them. Not for the believer. The believer didn't need it. He already knows. The Bible says that prophecy is for the believer. The gift of tongue was for the unbeliever. And he said, look, I'm going to send men in your language to preach to you, and you're going to understand it clearly, and yet you're not going to accept God. And this is before probation closed on Israel. This is before God shut the door on her and went to the Gentiles. God said, look, I'm going to send them. And that's why you would see them getting baptized, and they would start preaching in other languages. Why? Because people of other languages needed to know that Jesus was real, that God was born in the flesh, that Jesus had died and resurrected, and now salvation was available to all men. This is why the gift was given. And the devil in these last days is perverting the gospel. He's perverting it. And I know that many people who are listening tonight, even some in this room, I don't know, who have experienced it. I talked to one individual in this room last night, and he told me that he used to do it. I like to challenge you. The next time that goes to happen, if you are experiencing some supernatural manifestation, I want you to say clearly to God, Lord, if this is an unclean spirit, move it right now, and I guarantee you'll stop. I guarantee it can't stay. I've been in churches and in services where people started speaking in this unknown tongue. And as they started speaking, because I understand what the Bible says, believers shouldn't be doing it. It's not for believers. When I started hearing it, I start saying every time. Sometimes I get in a circle of prayer with people who were sometimes my neighbors who did it. And they didn't know. And I didn't want to embarrass my neighbor. I didn't want to just go and say, oh, the devil's speaking through you. Oh, that's not of God. No. See, the Bible says he that winneth souls is wise. You don't want to do something foolish. You don't want to run an innocent soul away. But what I would do when they start doing it, I say, in the name of Jesus, may every unclean spirit be removed. Do you know what? 100%. They stop immediately. Never has anyone come into my presence and tried to manifest that gift that was able to keep doing it. A Pentecostal pastor by the name of George Williams. He was baptized into God's Remnant Church. Nobody told him anything about it. Nobody taught him anything about that or the wedding ring or anything. They just was happy that he accepted the Sabbath. He gave a powerful testimony at one of my tent crusades, and there were about 40 Pentecostals who would not join the church because of that one subject. And when he got through giving that testimony and I made the appeal, they all came down and we baptized them that night. Well, you know, I told my church, I said to the church, I said, listen, you know, this is a sincere man of God. I said, but he doesn't know Adventism. And by the way, it's a lot more than just keeping the Sabbath. I mean, you can't just jump in this thing. You have to know what you're doing. And I said, I want to invite him to do a week of prayer at the church. And I said, you may see different things manifested that aren't normal. But we need to pray for him because he's sincere. My church said, Pastor, you don't have to ask us. And I didn't. My church believed in what I said. They believed it because everything that they got was a blessing. And they knew that I wasn't going to lead him the wrong way. And when he came, you could tell he was sincere. You could tell he was powerful. The first thing I did is taught him about that wedding ring. I said, I don't care what man told you. Let me show you what the Bible says about that. And guess what? He accepted the word. He took it off. That's a sign of being a man of God. When you see the word, you don't get mad. Well, one day we were sitting at my table, and I said, he had made a statement, and it seemed like he had said something in tongues from the pulpit, and I said, it's time to deal with it. And I said, brother, from the table, I said, you know, I need you to do me a favor. And I went to that same passage that I went to on pants with the ladies. I said, I want you to show me why you do it. Because I don't have to prove to you. You should be able to prove to me. And so he started going to every scripture he knew. But I said, no, but look at what it really means. And he kept, and I mean, he got angry, but it wasn't him. It was a demon. That spirit got so mad, you could see it. I mean, you could tell he wanted to hit me. I mean, I looked at him. I said, brother, what spirit is that? I mean, it's, you know, you're Holy Ghost filled. Do you know homosexuals speak in tongues while practicing homosexuality? Now, wait a minute now. Do you know that people speak in tongues and still go out and drink liquor and still go to parties? If it's a manifestation of being filled with the spirit, then certainly those things should be out of your life. So I looked at him and I said, hey, brother. Real gently. I didn't want to fight the brother in my kitchen. I said, brother, what spirit is that? I wasn't scared. You know why? Because fear is not of God. It wasn't a cocky like, well, you know, I could throw mine down with you. I just had peace. I said, brother, what spirit is that? And he looked at me. I said, why don't we go pray? Aren't we Christians? And that caught him when I said, what spirit? Because he identified. And whenever you find yourself outside of Christ, if you're sincere, the minute you see that, you're going to want to get it right. You're not going to want to be on the opposite side of Christ. And we went downstairs, and the Spirit of God spoke to him, and we bowed down and started praying, and he said, man, something left me, and he broke down crying like a baby. He said, for years, I did this. He never did it again from that point. His ministry is blossoming right now as we talk. He is on fire for the Lord right now as we talk. He is building bigger churches, and the way he became Adventist wasn't because somebody went looking for him. He turned his plate down. Let me tell you something, holiness and Pentecostals may need to learn the truth about the tongues, but they know about fasting and prayer and faith.
He turned that plate down and said, Lord, I'm not getting enough out the Bible. I want more. And for 30 days, he said, until I get more. At the end of 30 days, somebody knocked on his door and handed him a Sunday law book. He opened up that book and read and said, wait a minute. Started searching for the true Sabbath in the Bible and found that the true Sabbath was there. And he said, wait a minute. He called his bishop. Said, hey, bishop, guess what? I got some good news for you. He said, you don't think they're going to turn away from God's word. Bishop said, look, man, you've gone crazy. You want to keep the Sabbath? Keep it. But you keep the church going on Sunday. He went the next Sunday and said, oh, this is the last time we would do it today. The next Saturday, we will meet at Saturday. We are not going to meet any longer on Sunday. He said the next week when he came, it dropped from hundreds to only teens, maybe 20 people. He said, I know what this means. This must mean that God wants me to get a bigger building. Lord have mercy. Went out and got a bigger building. Didn't know nothing, didn't know anything about us. And finally, God sent someone to teach him. And today he's on fire. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you something. God is the same yesterday. He's the same today. He's always going to be the same. He speaks to us in a language that we can understand. And we speak to him in a language that we understand, but it goes beyond our understanding, because when you're in Christ, the Holy Spirit will utter without your help, will speak to God what you really need spoken. When your mind is clogged and you can't think of what to say, God looks at your need and he takes your need before the throne of God. And when you're in Christ, guess what? It's not only Christ at the throne mediating, it's you there with him. God sees you with his son. And he doesn't need anything in the way of it. And tonight around the world, I want to pray that God would give anyone victory, because you cannot substantiate it from the Bible. It doesn't matter how foggy it was tonight. The two things that weren't foggy are the two words, glossa and dialectos. Those are the only two, foreign language or native, motherland language, what I grew up learning. God loves all of us, and he wants us all to experience victory in Christ. He wants us to have it. Right now, he wants us to be free from anything. And it's no worse than being freed from tongues than being freed from anything else. If it's not of God, I don't want to do it, brothers and sisters. Our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for my brothers and sisters who are having a hard time right now, because some have experienced a lot of feeling behind this. But tonight, I'm asking that you would cause principle and the true convicting power of the Holy Spirit to help them to choose that which is only found in your word. As your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if Jesus didn't do it, I don't want to do it. I want Jesus to be my pattern. Jesus didn't do it. No one was more spiritual than him. Enoch didn't do it. He prophesied, the Bible says, but he didn't speak in tongues. As a matter of fact, there was none even around when Enoch preached. The whole gift of languages came in Genesis chapter 11 at the Tower of Babel, and it meant confusion. Tonight, God doesn't want us to be confused. He wants us to know the truth. And my prayer for you is that you would ask God, Lord, remove what I've experienced. I don't care how good it has been. I don't care what it's been like. Tonight around the world, I'm not picking on you. I love you. But God loves you more. And if you're sincere and you tell God, Lord, I don't ever want this to manifest again. I don't ever want it to manifest again. If it manifests after you pray that to God, you should really know it's not God, because God will not force himself on anybody. But it won't, brothers and sisters. God will free you. He'll free you. And it's nothing to be ashamed about. I want to tell you right now, some sitting in homes who are watching, some looking on the computer, some in churches that maybe have manifested around others who don't, it's nothing to be ashamed of. When we're in Christ, there's no shame. God is calling you to be a testimony and to bear a witness that I can never bear. So tonight, if you want to be found in Christ, you want to be one with Jesus, you want Jesus to have your heart, you want to abide in him, you want to be saved by the blood of Jesus, and you want to manifest the greatest gift of all, and that's love. If you want that opportunity, I want to manifest love. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet right now as I pray. Our Heavenly Father, it doesn't matter what denomination, it doesn't matter what race, it doesn't matter what language, it doesn't matter what our position is in life. We want tonight to reflect the love of Jesus. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would make that possible this night in this room.